Hello, you two. Yeah, I'm a few left the worse for wear. Which, you know, I've recorded a previous video and I've reviewed it and it's absolutely horrible. I mean, I'm going on, I'm yakking on and... ugh. So I think this way may be the only way that I actually talk some common sense, if you know what I mean. Because this is a complicated subject, and not only that, it's dependent on so many things. If you're in a rented property, for example, you might not be able to lay cable. If you're in a property where there's actually fragments of metal as part of the brickwork, then you might not be able to use wireless. Every room might be its own Faraday cage. So it's down to individual circumstances, shall we say. I can only tell you the choices that I faced. Now, one of the two choices that you face, if you've got a choice that is whether you go wireless or cable. I choose cable. Reason being is because I don't trust any of the figures that they put out for wireless. They say loads of figures. You know, they give you average distance for indoors. I think I'm actually working on wireless G, which has been around for the best part of a decade, quite common. And according to the stats, it's supposed to run for 40 meters. Sorry, 40 feet. I've got the stats here. Yeah, supposed to run for... no, good grief, it's actually supposed to run for 125 feet. I can tell you one thing. My home office, if I'm up there, and the G wireless kit down here, we're talking a distance as the crow flies of about, 20 to 30 feet. And I'm barely able to get a signal off it. So that's one thing, I don't trust any of the figures. And the further away you are, the less signal you're going to get, the less performance you're going to get. So I just don't trust what the wireless says is going to be up to. So because of that, I don't trust it for my core networking needs. Okay, the mobile phone can happily hook up to it. But if I want to, say, watch TV, stream a movie, or streaming music, there's hardly anything to music, to be honest. But if I want to do some heavy file transfer, I want a cabled connection. I don't want to be relying on wireless. And that was pretty much my conclusion when we came into the house, because we had to rewire the house. We didn't have much option. So I had cable laid. And there's different types of cable. There's different classifications. The two most common classifications in the here and now is category 5E and category 6. Now that's important on a number of things. And there's a few other things that are important regarding these things that the ISPs give you. Now, the home office is the home office. Pretty much most of their technology is in there. So it made sense to be able to have a hub, an information hub, a switch actually, but a communications hub, even though I'm saying hub, I don't mean hub as in operational hub, I mean operational switch, but an information hub. In that room, because there was going to be so much information in there, so much of the technology was going to be in there. It would have been common sense to put the router in that room, but I hit a number of problems. One was that the typical router you get from your ISP has only got a limited number of ports, 4, maybe 5 in some cases. Secondly, your ISP isn't exactly going to send you, if they're sending you one of these for free, they're not exactly going to send you top-notch equipment. So the ports on most of these are only operating at 10 megabits per second or 100 megabits per second. Now, over the last couple of years, if you bought a new PC or a new laptop, it's been able to operate at 1,000 megabits per second. You know, 10 times the 100 megabits per second rate. So your equipment can operate 10 times as fast as these ISP pieces of plastic junk will actually run at. So I bought a gigabit unmanaged switch, 16 ports, so I've got plenty of expansion. Well, actually a number of them are used. I computed my requirements. I needed more than 8 ports, so they're all wired in. So we've got a 16 port unmanaged switch. It hasn't got any wireless in it. It hasn't got any routing functionality in it. So for the money, I got a reasonable piece of kit because it does the one job. And that's at the hub there. So because all the equipment is capable of gigabit, it made sense to get a gigabit switch in the home office. I also had to up the cables, but because it's all in one room, category 6 cabling, the room wasn't too expensive. The rest of the house was only category 5E. That's what's in the walls, because it was, it was all we could afford at the time. Not only that, when you're messing around with category 6 in the walls, you're actually talking sockets which have got gold-plated connectors and all the rest of that jazz. You're talking money, which I didn't have. And I ain't taking the walls to pieces to lay Cat 6 in it now. But when you look at it, these devices only have 100 megabits per second tops. A category 6 cable between the switch and the router, waste of money, waste of effort. So for the other rooms in the house, running category 5E is perfectly acceptable. Now, we've got a CRT TV there. It's old. You know, if you drop that on your foot, not only will you break your foot, but you'll leave an indent of your foot in the concrete floor. That's how heavy the thing is. But if we ever manage to get it replaced with one of these LCD internet-ready TVs, 100 megabits per second is going to be perfectly adequate for streaming video. That's going to be perfectly adequate for streaming video for some years to come. So I'm not that bothered that the majority of the wall communication is Cat5e. It's not bothering me at all. When you look at the router, the communication between the switch and the router, even if that's 100 megabits per second, I'm only pulling down 7 megabits per second from the internet. You know, I'm not even pulling down a tenth of what that connection is capable of, even at 100 megabits per second. What's the point? So that's pretty much it. The room itself is geared for high speed gigabit. I can get away with it because I do a lot of file transfers. If somebody's come to me with a wrecked machine and I've got to rescue a hard drive, I've got an awful lot of information to shift from one machine to another. And 9 times out of 10, it's over the network. Even if it's... Sometimes it's faster than USB, trust me. because I've got a large server. If I've got a large server with space, it makes sense to use it. It makes sense to use that than sometimes having USB hard drives. Because you never know. A lot of these things are older. They haven't got USB 3. Some of them are struggling with USB 2. So, in that kind of environment, gigabits works. It's needed. But for the rest of the house, it doesn't need it. 100 megabit per second is perfectly adequate. I was left with no option but to put the router, my broadband router, next to the main phone line. We're a few miles away from the exchange in the middle of nowhere. This green line here is representing the telephone extensions, the standard voice telephone connections. Because I determined that if something goes wrong, if we need help, the more phones that are around, the better. At least a phone in every room, more or less. But the problem was, because we were so far away from the exchange, such a long telephone extension dragged down the signal. I had no option other than to put in a British Telecom amplifier unit right next to it. So the amplifier unit powers the extensions and doesn't drag down that connection. But because I've done that, the broadband router has to be there as well. Yes, in terms of a power cut, the BT amplifier would be dead once the battery backup is exhausted. So there is always one telephone which is connected straight in, and that's right next to that socket. But the broadband router has to be there. It has to be close to the main socket. Otherwise, we just get the broadband signal just falls off a cliff. And the amplifier does not amplify the broadband signal. It only amplifies the telephone voice signal. So that's pretty much how it's designed. The home office itself has its own reasonably high capacity switch, which serves all the machinery pretty much at a gigabit per second rate. The rest of the house doesn't need that kind of speed, so it's perfectly happy with Cat5e, which is running at 100 megabits per second. That's all it needs. Wireless, I don't trust it. I only use it for the mobile phone, and if somebody else happens to come with a laptop, then I'll give them the password and they can connect up. But I do not use the wireless for any heavy use. The more devices you've got on it, you know, your usage goes down, stuff like that. Security for wireless is another concern. You've got two primary methods of securing a home network, one of which is MAC address filtering, the other is your password. Now, the MAC address filtering, you can forget about it. I mean, so if you were using MAC address filtering, if you don't know what MAC address filtering is, every device pretty much has a MAC address. It's what enables one machine to talk to another at a very basic level. It's called a machine address, hence MAC. MAC being short for machine. And it's what enables devices to talk to each other on a basic level, as I just said. By using MAC address filtering, you can say only machines with these MAC addresses can talk with the wireless system. Otherwise, ignore the traffic. You face a problem administratively. Say a friend comes to the house with a machine and you want to give them access to your wireless network. You've got to find out first what their MAC address is. Then you've got to get onto your router and program the MAC address in. Typically on some machines that will need a reboot of the router, which will take your entire network down while the router reboots. So what do you gain for that? Sweet FA, because if a hacker wants to get into your network and they're monitoring your communications, then they will see the MAC addresses that are flying around, and all they will simply do is reprogram their kit to have the same MAC address as the equipment that they've seen talking on your network. MAC address filtering is an administrative overhead, and you're not gaining very much in terms of security. Your only key security, as far as I personally am concerned, is your password, is your wireless password. There are various degrees of security: WEP, WPA, TKIP, AES, AES. And typically you want to go for the strongest setting you can. The password that you use, use as strong a password as you can. Mix uppercase with lowercase, numbers, symbols, whatever your router will take, use it. Your SSID key. You know, if you tell a device to browse what wireless devices are around, you got the SSID key because it's been broadcast, so you can see it. If your router doesn't broadcast the SSID, then typically nothing can see it, or that's what you think. In actual fact, there's not much difference. If a hacker was doing it, they'd be able to work out what wireless systems were around, and they'd be able to work out the SSID keys anyway. So there's not much to be gained from hiding the SSID key. Once a hacker has got the SSID key, then they can go away and make what we call a rainbow table. Once they've got that rainbow table, then they can come back and they can basically hack your network in a few minutes. Now, once you've got that password, you've selected the strongest encryption you can use. You've written your password down, you've created it, you've written it down because it's complicated. That's pretty much as secure as you're going to be. If a hacker wants to get into your wireless, they're going to get into your wireless. There's not a lot with current technologies that are available to the home that will stop the determined hacker. Nothing that I personally know of that's easily available on the market for the home user. pretty much these days, ISPs have woken up to the fact that the home users, a good portion of the home users, don't have the knowledge to be able to set up the password security system. So the ISPs will actually do it for you. When you receive your wireless routing device in the post, it should typically come these days with a card that tells you what password they've programmed onto it already for you. And that's pretty much as secure as you can be. There is two wireless devices. The one downstairs, I can't even get a decent signal when I'm up in the home office, so I put a second repeater up there. Repeaters are some things that people don't realize exists. Particularly people in rented accommodation, they've got problems with signals, and they don't realize that repeating technology is around. There are a number of types. One of the most common is a repeater that talks back to the original by a cable. But there are repeaters around that will repeat via wireless. So you can, it will take a weak signal, you put it strategically in a strategic place, and it will help boost the signal to another set of distance. So technology does exist for you to be able to use wireless more effectively. And again, it depends on your circumstances. If you've got a nice long garden, you might be perfectly happy to have an N-series router in the top window that's broadcasting out across your garden. You don't, if you don't care that the neighbors are getting the signal as well, then in your garden you've got access to your wireless network. So that's pretty much the design. The office is running fast as I can get it for reasonable value for money. It communicates with the rest of the house and outside because of speeds. What's the point? You know, they're perfectly adequate speeds. 100 megabit per second is perfectly adequate for most households. But wireless, I just don't believe. It's up to the job, but I just don't believe it. It lives up to its figures. Also, with the number of channels that are available, if you've got more powerful network equipment, a lot of the stuff is now on wireless N. My mobile phone actually works on wireless N. That standard was released a couple of years ago, I think. And more devices are starting to use it. It's more powerful. When a lot of people started moving from dial-up to broadband, I was perfectly happy to stay on dial-up because it meant that I could dial up easier. My access was easier because it was a less crowded route. Pretty much everybody's on DSL now, including me. And, you know, there's contention problems. A lot of people using the service at the same time. It's pretty much the same for wireless. If you've got a lot of people with wireless signals on the same sort of frequency, only you're limited by the number of channels. I think the UK has got 11 channels on G, whereas Australia's got 14 or something like that. You know, different regulators are stepping in and changing things. Some of the routers are actually limited. I think one of the earlier BT routers that was supplied by Netgear, that was limited. And you could actually download firmware which would boost, once you downloaded that particular firmware to your router, it would boost your signal from your router at no extra cost. But of course it was illegal to do so because you'd be operating at powers which weren't regulated for the country. But wireless is a bit of a world of pain, whereas wired connections, I know, I trust, they're there, and if I can run the cables so that they don't interfere with mains, or they don't get interference off mains, then I'm pretty happy that I'm going to get the best performance I can. And that's about it. Office, fast, cables weren't too much money. Nice and quick, does the job because I need the speed on some operations. The rest of the house, category 5E, 100 megabits per second, because streaming TV or talking to the internet, it doesn't need gigabit at the minute. And even if I was capable of it, I probably wouldn't go for it because of the extra cost. ADSL2, on the other hand, if I could up my broadcast speed, my outgoing speed, I'd be happier. But I won't do that yet. They still want us all to be nice consumers, as opposed to contributors to the internet. So there you go. That's pretty much how it works out. The trick is to work out what you need, where, and to design a system that's going to work for you within your instructions. That's about it. I hope that answers the question. If there's more specific questions on the network design, let me know. But I'm aware that this is taking, good grief, this is now just over 20 minutes, and this is just a basic overview, because there are so many different possibilities. There are so many different figures, tricks, traps, and considerations with designing this sort of stuff, you know? Oof, I could go on all day. So take care, and if there's any more specific questions on how some of this stuff is put together, let me know. But for now, good night, YouTube.